Welcome to our Christmas Eve service. On this night, we remember that holy night in which God entered our world to become one with us. Tonight, as we enter into that mystery, it's good to be together. For those who have joined us as guests here tonight, a special welcome to you. For those who have joined us online or local cable, we too pray that you might bow before that newborn king. I'm reminded of the words of Isaiah chapter 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. Those living in that land of darkness, the light has dawned. That God has come to us as Emmanuel, God with us. I invite you at this time to stand, if you are able, to receive the Emmanuel's blessing. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father, from God the Son, and from God the Holy Spirit. And all God's people respond by saying together, Amen. As God has greeted us, I invite you to turn to your neighbor in that historic greeting, the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Greet one another at this time.
Without hope in the stillness of sin, the world lay in wait, waiting for a way out of the darkness, waiting for a Savior, breathless. And in one perfect moment, the wait was over. In the same way, each one of us began our life here on earth. God took a breath, breath of heaven, God's perfect gift.
Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift.
We thank you, God, for the breath of your Son, Jesus, both his first and his last, without which we would remain in darkness. Jesus said, I have come as a light into the world, so that everyone who believes in me should not remain in darkness.
Thank you, God, for the breath of heaven,
your perfect gift.
Today the Savior is born in the city of David. He is Christ the Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life is the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, and the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Oh, holy night. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said,
"Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you."
Mary was greatly troubled at these words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her,
"Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end."
"How will this be, since I am a virgin?"
"The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God."
"I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled."
Then the angel left her.
We light this candle in hope, knowing that all of God's promises will be fulfilled. Emmanuel, the child of promise and the sign of hope, has arrived.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their town to register.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth to Galilee to Judah, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David.
He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
We light this candle of peace. Jesus, the root of Jesse, has been born in the line of David, and he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn son And she wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them.
We light this candle of joy. Jesus, the light of the world, has come, and his birth has changed everything.
Shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them,
"Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger."
Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
"Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
They hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart.
We light this candle of love. Jesus, the morning star, has come and is chasing the shadows of the night away.
We light the Christ candle because Christ has come. The shepherds and magi heard the message that had been born, that he had been born. They came quickly to worship him, but Jesus was destined to live and walk among people who did not receive him nor worship him.
The innkeeper, who made room for Mary and Joseph, would soon be replaced by the Pharisees, secretly plotting to find a way to keep him out.
The shepherds and wise men, worshiping with gusto, would soon be replaced by a crowd chanting, "Crucify him, crucify him, for this is the Beth, for this is Jesus of Bethlehem and Nazareth and Calvary."
Jesus of the lakeshore and the city.
Jesus, the friend of tax collectors and prostitutes.
Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross.
Good Christian people.
I'm going to preach tonight. I'm going to ponder a little bit. You know how to ponder, don't you? We read in God's Word, you've heard it tonight already in the story, how Mary pondered and treasured all these things that had occurred. When you ponder, you try to put the pieces together, if you will, connect the dots. And so for a few minutes tonight, I invite you to ponder the story that we have just heard. You can't microwave this pondering. It's kind of like awe and wonder, trying to take it all in. Some people can microwave awe for a second. I know I've spent numerous hours at Disneyland and Disney World. One of the things that I enjoy the most is watching children. Children with wide eyes of awe and wonder as they enter into their favorite story. But this isn't a fairy tale story, is it? This isn't about once upon a time. This is the story. This is God's story. This is the story that changed my life. I hope yours as well. It's a story that changed the trajectory of the world, in which God entered into this world in order that we might one day enter into heaven. So we sit and we ponder a bit tonight all of these things that have occurred. It's my prayer that we might wander. I know we use that term these days to describe this most wonderful time of the year, but I think we mean it in a different way. After all, this season is filled with muchness. Much of the festivities associated with the season. We need to slow down a bit and ponder the most important thing. There's an old story, and perhaps I've shared it with you before. A story that comes out of Europe a number of years ago. It was a very wealthy and powerful couple that just gave birth to their firstborn. And they were going to have a christening party for their firstborn. They invited their family and friends to join them. Of course, it was cold, and so they had their coats on. A servant greeted them, collected their coats, and brought them into a nearby bedroom. The family and friends enjoyed the hors d'oeuvres and their conversation, and then it was time for the christening. Where's the baby? They were looking all over. Where's the baby? Oh, one remembered. I think I saw that baby in that room where all the coats. And sure enough, nearly smothering the baby. We can do that during this time of the year. Get caught up with all the festivities that we may not remember what this is all about. This is about life. This is about God. And so tonight, as I sit with you, we sit with Mary to ponder and treasure a bit, in a way, what I call the unbelievable. I know that word sometimes gets into our vocabulary. I hear sports announcers, for example, trying to describe something that's hard to describe, and they shout out, unbelievable. Well, it is. Perhaps Mary, as she ponders and treasures these things, is is thinking about this unbelievable as she looks into that night sky, and today with Hubble, we can see far off into that seemingly infinite universe. And Hubble shows us that dark matter and shows us a bit of that space, 10 billion, trillion stars. Can you imagine? The great God of gods who created this universe out of nothing. That great God who continues to create new stars and manage the whirling masses. It's that great God who shrunk himself into a baby. God became what God was not. Let that sink in for a moment. The infinite one became a wee one. The one who is eternal enters into our time and space. And perhaps as Mary ponders and treasures this, she has this sense of this unbelievable. I share that with you tonight. Think about it. The unbelievable dignity that God sees in each and every one of you, that he would come to us. The unbelievable empathy that God enters into our pain and our suffering, into the evil of our world in order to take it upon himself. Perhaps Mary ponders that. Ponders this baby who is in that cradle. And as we've heard already tonight, that's not the end of the story. For this baby will journey to a cross and to a grave to conquer that grave in order to set us free. We ponder that hope tonight, Jesus' words, because I live, you also will live. Ponder, treasure, the unbelievable, or as Paul describes it, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. I wonder what else Mary pondered and treasured. I wonder if she pondered the fulfillment of God's promises. After all, in the Old Testament, there over and over again you hear of God's promise that he will come for his people. You know, Mary, and I know we've read stories about her, but I invite you to imagine again this teenager who, living out in the sticks, out in this place called Nazareth, she's called an anomam, a poor one. And her world has been rocked and shocked by this message. And yet, she is a very theologically and profound teen. And in a sense, I believe she gets it. Because if you turn back to Luke chapter 1, she pens a song we call the Magnificat, in which she speaks about God's promises. She speaks about how that Son of David would come to establish that eternal kingdom. She speaks about Abraham and how his seed would be that blessing to the nations. I wonder if this is what Mary's pondering and treasuring. I wonder if she recalled those words of Isaiah that you see on the screen. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. And he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from from that time on and forever. Perhaps she dreamed of what that future might look like when God's shalom breaks out in this world. Oh, Mary treasures and ponders these things. But I also wonder if she pondered the events of these days, months, if you will, how God broke in to this world. I like to call it an invasion, as he sends that heavenly host, his army, into this world, and certainly led by Gabriel, who's got that message, a message repeated four times. First to old Zachariah and Elizabeth, when they are rocked with that news, you're going to have a son too. And the angel says, don't be afraid. To Mary, who asked that question, how can it be that I would have a child? And the angel says, don't be afraid, Mary. Remember, all things are possible with God. And to those shepherds out in the field who are rocked by that laser light show, and I'd be afraid too if I was them, but the angel said, don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Tonight, as you sit here with Mary, I remind you that's what God says to us. Don't be afraid. I am Emmanuel. I am with you. Perhaps as you sit here tonight, you have fears about what's going to happen tomorrow, fears what's going to happen. God says, don't be afraid. You might think like a Mary or those shepherds, well, what about me? I mean, I'm just on a whim, if you will. Just this person. Why would God care about me? That's the beauty of the story. This story that's not once upon a story, a time once, excuse me, a story that's not once upon a time, but a story that's written in history when Caesar Augustus thought he was a big shot, when he thought he ruled the world, God moved in. And God comes to those who are poor, to those who may be left out. I always love that part of the story when God comes to the angels. I mean, you'd think he'd come to the big shots, the kings and the queens and people like that. No, no, no. God makes that point very clear as the Father proclaims the birth of his Son to those shepherds, those who were marginalized, those who we would call people living out on the streets. They didn't seem to fit. They didn't look right. They didn't smell right. And yet, who does God come to? He comes to those who desperately need that good news. Shepherds, Mary, you, me. Don't be afraid. This is for you. Oh, as I ponder a treasure, along with Mary, this good news, I'm reminded of her song. I'm reminded of the songs, and certainly Christmas reminds us of singing to give expression to our joy and as well as our wonder. I think of that great Magnificat that Mary sings. My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. I think of old Zechariah, who hadn't spoken for 9 months, and when he does speak, it's in song, blessed be the name of our Lord God. And certainly we are reminded of the angel's song, glory to God in the highest. Well, perhaps Mary sings that song over her baby. I wonder also what she called him. And she'd call him Jesus, my Savior, my Lord, Yahweh to the rescue, Emmanuel, the firstborn over all creation. I wonder. But tonight, as we ponder and treasure, I remind you, it calls for a response. Oh, indeed, to adore him, but also to remind each other how Mary and those shepherds responded. Mary gave her life to God's promise and said, let it be to me even as you have said. I will be your servant. And I think about those shepherds who responded to that angel's message by ambling across that countryside, waiting to bow before that newborn king. Did they understand how appropriate that was? Because they stared into the face of God. Not only that, they didn't go back to those sheep. They went back to that village, a hooting and a hollering about the good news. The good news that will change everything. Tonight, what's our response? God has entered this world, the God of gods, this little planet out in the middle of nowhere. And yet, at the heart of it all, it's about God's gift to you, to this world. That's what it's about. And this gift has your name on it. And it's all about love. That's why you are here tonight. Because God created you out of his love. If there's any basic need in our life, it's that to be loved as well as to love. And you've heard it said before, there's nothing that you can do to earn God's love. It comes from his character, not our conduct. And this gift, well, it comes from God's heart. For you. As we read in that famous verse, John 3, verse 16, God so loved the world that he gave. See, it's one thing to say I love you, but it's another thing to come and give your very best gift, yourself. That's what God has done. But if you remember that verse, it's to whoever would accept this gift. I'm a whoever. And so are you. Tonight, once again, God says, here's my gift of love to you. But there's something else about this gift. I remind you, it is also that gift of his presence, Emmanuel with us. Sometimes we may not feel that way. Sometimes we may feel abandoned. Sometimes we get beat up by this world. But God says, remember, I will be with you even to the end of the age. There's something else. This gift also promises that freedom. God has come to set us free from that guilt and shame of our own sins. That's a heavy load to carry around. God says to us tonight, you believe in me, you accept my gift, you walk out of here without that load because I have taken it through my son Jesus Christ. As Mary ponders, may we ponder that amazing gift of salvation, that amazing gift that he sets us free from fear. You know, the heart of faith is not when life is really going well. It's when we go through those difficult times, when relationships get rocked, when we may lose our health or find our resources limited. God says, I never created you to go alone. I want you to walk with me. And even when you face that great enemy, remember it's defeated because of Jesus Christ. Tonight, we celebrate that gift. And the gift of peace that God pours out into our life the peace that says, you are right with me. I love you. And we're going to do life together. Remember the words of that angel, this peace is on those whom God's favor rests. It's on those who open their arms and say to God, yes, I need that gift of peace. And oh, how our world needs that gift of peace. You and I know that very well. But God has called us then to accept that gift and go in his peace as his peacemakers. As we've lit these candles tonight again, we're reminded that God has brought that light into our world, that light of hope and joy and peace and love, but not meant to keep it to ourselves. No, no, no. No, to be his lights in this world. To be his lights. I close with those words of our Lord, who declared, I am the light of the world, but then he says to us, you are the light of the world. And that familiar illustration, a town built on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they might see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. What does God want for Christmas this year? What does he want for you and me? That obedience. That we've accepted the gift and we go in his name. To be that light bearers in our dark world. To point to the one who has saved us. Point to that one who has given us life and eternal life. Let's pray. Oh God, we come tonight to ponder again and treasure this gift, the greatest gift in all the world, a gift that never grows old, a gift of life and eternal life, a gift that we desperately need. And we thank you again for this wonderful gift. Tonight, it's our prayer that we might indeed be your light bearers, that we might say to our world, just like those shepherds of old, we've seen him, we've seen the King of Kings who has come to save us. Send us out tonight as those light bearers, we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. We're going to respond in song tonight by singing a song, The Wonder of Wonders. And as the praise team is coming up, I remind you that we have an opportunity to respond to God's grace tonight by giving of our offerings. And our offerings are designated tonight for a local agency called Love in the Name of Christ, a way that we can express love to those who perhaps do not know that love of God and what it looks like. Also, during the singing of our song, our ushers are going to come forward and light your candles that you have in your pews. I urge you to be careful as you receive those lights. Let's sing together, The Wonder of Wonders.
Could it be that
Time, I invite you to stand. You surprised the world, O God, by coming not in clashing thunder or in flashing lights, but in the quiet and simple splendor of a child's radiant face.
Help us to understand this mystery of love beyond all loves, that we may be led to a new kind of love.
A love that loves not by what we can get, but in what we can give. A love that counts not who is worthy to receive, but beyond our human calculations is showered freely on all.
Show us the way of Bethlehem's child. That in seeing we may believe, and in believing we may love deeper and more generously. Amen.
May the grace of our Lord and Savior, the Word made flesh, the love of God the Father, and that ongoing presence bless you with love and joy and hope and peace. And all God's people say together, Amen.
We're going to close with Peace, Peace. So if you know the parts to Peace, Peace, that section, please sing along. And otherwise, when the silent night comes in, join us there. Okay.
Oh, to